Everyone, in this session, we'll be discussing the analysis of lateral forces on the building frames. In general, up till now, we have been discussing the analysis of frames or mortar frames considering only the dead loads and live loads, which actually act in the vertical direction. But in actual or real life scenarios, a mortar frame is subjected to lateral forces as well. These lateral forces may be in the form of earthquake excitations or in the form of wind load. And in order to take or analyze the effect of these forces on the structure, we are hereby undertaking the analysis. Now, how to carry out the analysis? In order to obtain the bending moments and shear force in the various members of the frame, we have prominently three methods. The first one is portal method, the second is cantilever, and the third one is factor method. These methods are collectively called as approximate method of analysis because certain approximation or assumptions are made in the analysis in order to make our calculations easy. Because in real life or in actual conditions, a portal frame is actually highly indeterminate, and as such, in order to analyze all the forces or all the members, we need a huge amount of extra equations which are not technically feasible or possible. So in order to reduce our calculations and to apply the principles of mechanics easily, we take certain assumptions. Before starting, one term that would be recurring in all the analysis is the point of contraflexure. So let us discuss what is point of contraflexure. Point of contraflexure is the point or section in a beam or column at which the bending moment is zero, and as such, analogically, it is similar to an internal hinge, and its action would be similar to internal hinge, right? So let's start with our first method, that is the portal method. So portal method basically, in the portal method we have three assumptions. First one is the horizontal force. Whatever horizontal or lateral forces are acting on the frame, they are acting at the joints only. The point of contraflexure of all the members lie at their midpoints, and the horizontal shear is taken by the interior columns is twice that of the horizontal shear taken by the outside or windward or leeward columns, right? It would be more clear by a diagram here. Let us take an example. So for this particular portal frame, we are supposed to analyze the bending moment and shear force in various beams and columns. So the first step would be to apply the assumptions. As you can see here, the first assumption was the horizontal shear or horizontal forces are acting at the joints. The second one was the point of contraflexure are supposed to act at to be present at the midpoint of the various members. These are the point of contraflexure, and physically these would be acting just similar to a internal hinge, right? Meaning that the shear would be transferred ahead of these internal hinges, but no moment would be transferred, right? And the next assumption was the interior columns take the twice horizontal shear as that of the external column. So we have taken the first step, we have applied the assumptions, and we have obtained the portal frame as shown. Now in order to analyze the horizontal shear that is acting on each and every story, we just take the equation of statics and thereby calculate the value of P and R. Taking the horizontal shear above the MM axis here, we can easily calculate, or we can easily obtain P as P plus 2P plus 2P plus P would be equal to 120. Thereby we'll be getting the P as equal to 20 kilonewton. So we find that the shear in column AE, the shear in column AE, that would be equal to P, and that is equal to 20 kilonewton. For the interior columns, like for the column BF, we'll be getting 2P, that is 40 kilonewton, and so on. For different members or different columns of the top story, we'll be getting the value of horizontal shears. Now for the bottom story, at let's say for the column C, for the column EI, as we can see, the horizontal, the shear force that would be acting, that would be balancing this R force, that would be summation of 120 and 180, because shear force is basically the summation of all the forces taken from one edge to the other, right? So this R would be balanced by this R, this 2R and R would in whole be balanced out by 180 plus 120 kN. The effect of P and 2P would be balanced out by each other as they are acting in the opposite directions. So here you can see we have calculated or analyzed the value of R as well. And as such, we have calculated the shear or horizontal shear in various bottom story columns as well. So we have obtained the shears 50 kN and 100 kN in different members. Now the next thing would be to analyze the moment at the ends of the column, right? Considering only the first column of the top story, as you can see in the column AE at joint E, a clockwise moment would be generated because of P into 1.75, and again a clockwise moment would be generated due to this R force. So effectively the total moment that would be created on E would be P plus R into 1.75. Considering only the member EA, if we say what would be the bending moment at joint E in the member EA, that would be because of the P force only. And similarly the moment in the member E and I, that would be equal to R into 1.75. So as you can see, we have calculated the value of bending moment at the various joints of the portal frame, and thereby we have analyzed the value of bending moment at the ends of the columns, right? So just by multiplying this force by its perpendicular distance, we can calculate the bending moment acting at the end of the column. Similarly, for the bottom story, we have used just simple equations of bending moment. Now, in order to calculate the bending moment at the end of a beam, we just use the equilibrium of joint concept, as we have already discussed in the previous topic. In order to apply the equation of statics or mechanics, it is assumed that the whole system is in equilibrium, and as such, each and every joint and member is also in equilibrium. Considering the same concept, we determine what would be the moment acting at the ends of the beam. As you can see here, we analyze the bending moment that was generated in various members using above method, and we calculated the bending moment that was generated at the ends of the columns, right? So considering the joint E, we find that for the member EA, the moment was clockwise 35 kN/m, and the member EI, it was 87.5 kN/m. So effectively at the joint E, for the columns only, 122.5 kN/m was the effective clockwise rotation. But since the joint E is in equilibrium, so the compensating moment has to be generated by the beam. So in order to compensate this clockwise 122.5 kN/m, anti-clockwise moment would be generated at the point or joint E in the beam. Let's say, what is the beam? The beam would be, I guess, EF. The beam EF, right? So basically, since clockwise 122.5 kN was generated at joint E because of the moment in the columns, to counterbalance that, a 122.5 kN anticlockwise was generated in the adjacent beam. So by that concept, we can calculate what would be the bending moment generated in different beams, just by taking into consideration what is the end moment in the column adjacent to it, right? So by that, similarly, as you can see here also, for the floor beam at point A, we had obtained the clockwise moment to be P into 3.5/2, and since it is a clockwise moment and joint A is also in equilibrium, anticlockwise moment P into 3.5 would be generated in the beam. So using this concept, we have developed or analyzed the value of bending moment in the beams. Now, having obtained what would be the bending moment in the beams, we can easily calculate or analyze the shear forces that would be generated in the beam. As you can see, we have a simple concept that we have discussed earlier as well. Let us consider a beam AB, and if a anticlockwise moment M is acting at joint A, for the beam to be in a stable condition, m by l force should be acting on in a sense that creates a clockwise moment, and thereby the beam AB remains in equilibrium. So from that concept we can obtain what would be the value of forces that would be acting at the edges of the beam AB. Similar concept has been used here. Consider the beam EF in the lower story. As we have already discussed, we calculated the bending moment in the beam and it was coming out to be anticlockwise 122.5 kN. Similarly, at joint F for the beam EF, we were getting anticlockwise 122.5. So thereby we were getting anticlockwise 245 kN unbalanced moment. So in order to balance that moment, the forces that would be generated at E and F would be 245/7, 7 is the length, and at E that would be acting in the upward direction, and at F it would be acting in the downward direction, thereby creating a clockwise moment. So thereby the anticlockwise would be balanced out by the clockwise. So thereby, using this concept, we have analyzed what would be the forces at the ends of various beam simply by using the bending moment that were obtained earlier, right? So having obtained these forces at the end of the beams, again by the equilibrium concept, we can calculate or determine what would be the axial forces acting in the adjoining column. By that, what I mean is, we have analyzed what would be, let's say, for the EF. For EF, we found that the force was acting in the downward direction. So the column adjacent to it would be having a axial force in the upward direction, right? So whatever direction, in whatever direction the shear force or the edge force was acting in the beam, in the opposite direction, we'll be getting the axial force in the adjacent column, right? So using that concept, we have determined what are the axial shears in the members or the columns, and thereby our whole portal frame has been analyzed, right? So the next method is cantilever method. Again, this method also has certain assumptions. For this particular method, we have again point of contraflexure in each member lie at the midpoint. The direct stresses in the column due to the horizontal forces are directly proportional to their distance from the centroidal vertical axis of the frame. This would be more clear. The second assumption means, let's say the centroidal axis lies here only, lies somewhere here. So the direct stresses in the columns, the stresses that would be acting, axial stresses that would be acting in the column, would be in proportion to the distance of that particular column with respect to the centroidal axis distance, right? As you can see here. So first of all, again we have taken the same problem. No, the problem is different. So again, in this problem we are supposed to analyze what are the forces or moment that have been generated using just by the cantilever method. Now here, so first step would be, we are supposed to analyze what would be the centroidal axis as far as the moments are as far as the columns are concerned, right? So we'll be taking, let's say, the areas of all the columns are assumed to be constant, right? And thereby, taking only the columns into consideration, we determine what would be the CG of the columns, right? So for the first two columns, we have 2A that would be multiplied by 0, considering A3 as our origin. 2A into 0 plus 2A into 7.5, 7.5 represents distance of these two columns, plus 2A into 11.25, 11.25 would be the distance of these two columns with respect to A3, and 2A into 16.25 for the last two columns, and divided by the total area that is considered of the columns, and thereby we'll be getting with respect to A3 what is the location of the centroidal axis of the whole column area, right? Having obtained the x bar, we can calculate what would be the distance of particular column or particular line of columns with respect to the centroid, and we have determined these distances represented as x, a, b, c and d for the column line a1, a2, a3, b1, b2, b3, c1, c2, c3 and d1, d2, d3. Next part, next step, that would be to analyze the axial forces in the column, right? In order to determine that, we have taken for the column A1, A2 that the axial shear axial force that is acting is VA. For B1, B2 it is VB. For C1, C2 it is VC, and for D1, D2 it is VD. Taking these forces and by applying the second assumption, that was the distance, the axial force that is acting in particular member is proportional to its distance with respect to the centroidal axis, we get these proportional relation, right? And thereby we'll be getting the different axial forces in terms of VA. Now by simply applying or simply taking the moment with respect to the end point, by considering the moment of all the forces with respect to this end point here again is the point of contraflexure, and as such the bending moment about it is also zero. Considering the effect of all these forces with respect to the end point on the levered means, since the force is acting in this direction, this point would be in the windward direction, while the backside is considered as the levered side of the portal frame, right? So taking moment about N on the levered column, we can finally obtain what would be the value of VA, and once VA is obtained, VB, VC and VD can be calculated. Now here, one important assumption or one important observation is that since this 90 kN would be creating a clockwise moment about the base of the building or about the base of the frame, it is mandatory to create an anti-clockwise moment, and as such the shear on the left would be acting downwards and on the right it would be upward, thereby creating a clockwise moment as the external force is creating anti-clockwise moment, right? So using this basic assumption, we analyze or we obtain the value of VA, VB, VC and VD. Similar calculations are done in order to determine the axial forces in the lower stories, right? And thereby we'll be getting VA dash, VB dash, VC dash and VD dash. Once we have obtained what are the values of axial shears in the columns, we can apply these axial shears for the beams, right? For the A1, A2, A1, B1, C1, D1, we are getting this is the particular set of shear force that is acting. And using these shear force or these forces, we can actually calculate the bending moment or moment that would be generated in the ends of the particular beam spans. Let's say I am supposed to calculate the what is the bending moment in the A1, B1, right? So for that, for the moment at joint A1 in the member A1, B1, we are supposed to determine what is the shear, and we are supposed to multiply it by half of the span. Why half of the span? Because at this point we are getting a point of contraflexure, meaning at this point the bending moment is zero. So whatever shear is acting here, let's say this is 9.8 kN acting downwards, it would be balanced out by the 9.8 kN acting upwards. Thereby the moment at this joint A1 would be 9.81 into span by 2. This simple concept has been used and has been applied in order to determine what is the value of bending moment at the ends of various beams. And having obtained what is the value of bending moment in the ends of beam, again by using the equilibrium of joint, we can calculate or obtain what would be the value of bending moment in the columns, right? And at a particular joint, if different moments are acting for the different members, again equilibrium has to be satisfied. Let's say for the member, let's say for a particular member, member A1, B1, for a member A2, B2, for a member A2, B2, if you are supposed to analyze what would be the moment equation or what would be the summation of the moments acting, we can observe that at joint A2, we are having M A2 A1, we are having M A2 B2, we are having M A2 A3. So the total equilibrium of the joint has to be maintained, and thereby M A2 B2 will be equal to A2 A3 plus
A2 A1 considering their rotation or their direction of rotation that are create that these moments are creating on the joint A2. So by that, using the equilibrium condition for the joint, we can obtain what would be the value of bending moment for the beams, and thereby we will be able to analyze the whole portal frame. Now the next method of analysis is the portal the next method is the factor method of analysis. This is the most generalized method, and as such it is the most accurate method of all the three, and it is useful when the moment of inertia of different members are different, right? Meaning that the section is non-prismatic. And basically this method is a step by step procedure. It is having a step by step procedure, and it does not it only utilizes the concept that have been already discussed before, and as such I have only discussed here the steps that are supposed to be followed in order to determine the bending moment and shear forces in the member. So first of all, we are supposed to calculate the girder factor small g. The girder factor is equal to the summation of relative stiffness, the summation of relative stiffness of all the columns at a joint, at any joint, with respect to the sum of relative stiffness of all the members meeting at the joint. Having obtained the girder factor, we can calculate the column factor small c, that is 1 minus g at a particular joint. For a column fixed at the base, at the fixed end we are having the c as 1. Having obtained the small c and small g, we are supposed to calculate the capital G and capital C, which are the column or girder moment factors. Having obtained the c and g for various members, we are supposed to utilize the concept of carryover. Let's say we are having a member AB. So if we have calculated or analyzed the C factor at joint E, half of it would be transferred to B, and from B half of the C value would be transferred to A, right? And effective value of C or G would be obtained by summing the values after transferring from the two ends, from the farther end and from the nearer end. And this capital C and G factors would be obtained by multiplying the small c and g by the particular stiffness of a member, right? So having obtained capital C or capital G, we are supposed to calculate what would be the value of A for a particular story. Now, one important thing, the column moment factor C for a particular column in a particular story actually determines the relative proportion of the total moment generated by the horizontal shear on that particular story that is borne by the considered column. What does this mean? That if moment generated in a particular story, the moment generated due to the horizontal shear is, let's say, 100 kilonewton meter, and a particular column on that story has the column moment factor as 1.2, then the moment that would be borne or that would be taken by that particular column would be equal to 100 upon summation of C for all the columns on that story multiplied by 1.2. So basically this C value determines what value of the moment created by the horizontal shear on a particular story would be taken by a particular column, right? As you can see here, this H multiplied by H, small h, is basically the moment that is generated due to horizontal shear on a particular story, and this summation C is equivalent to the summation C of all the columns on that story. So we are supposed to calculate the A value, and this A value is constant for one particular story, right? So once we have obtained A for a particular story, we are just supposed to multiply it with the capital C value for any considered column in order to determine what moment would be taken out by that particular column. Similar to the concept as discussed here, in order to calculate the beam or girder moments, we are supposed to calculate the factor B, and in order to determine what would be the value of moment that would be taken by a particular girder on a joint, we are supposed to multiply this B with the girder moment factor G for that particular considered beam and column, and thereby we'll be getting the value of moment that would be generated in that particular beam, right? So once we have calculated the C or G, we are supposed to calculate A, and once we have calculated A, we can simply multiply it by the C for a particular column, and thereby we'll be getting the value of moment for a particular column. And in order to determine the moment for a girder or a beam, we are supposed to calculate B for a particular joint, and this B value is multiplied by the girder moment factor for any beam or girder to determine what would be the moment for that girder. Here we haven't discussed any problem, as the problem involving this method are lengthy. But if you are able to understand what is the procedure, you can easily calculate or analyze the portal frame. The next topic that is to be discussed is the analysis of space frame by tension coefficient method. Basically, it is a modified form of method of section or method of joint that were initially used in order to analyze trusses, right? So before starting, it is important to know what is a tension coefficient for a particular member. For a member AB at the joint A, the tension coefficient is determined or defined as the pull at joint A of the member AB determined by the length of AB, that is TAB is equal to T upon LAB. So tension coefficient is nothing but the tension coefficient for a particular member is nothing but the tension that is acting in the member divided by its length. This method is used in order to take the coordinates of different points of a truss into account, and thereby avoiding the analysis of cos theta and sin theta, right? So the analysis is somehow simplified, as we are not indulged in analyzing the thetas, and just by taking the ordinates with respect to x, y and z axis of various points on the truss, we can analyze the forces in the different members of the truss. So as you can see here, we are having a member AB, and it is inclined at angle theta with respect to x axis. Using the tension coefficient method, in general analysis as we used to do in the method of section, in order to apply the equation of static, we would have taken the component of this force along the x and along the y direction, and by that we would have taken out the we would have done the analysis. But in this case, in this method, the AB cos theta is replaced by TAB XB minus XA, where B is the x XB is the x ordinate of the farther point and A is the x ordinate of the nearer point. Similarly, AB sin theta is to be replaced by TAB into YB minus YA. YB is the Y ordinate of point B and YA is the Y ordinate of point A. Length of member AB can be calculated here. Similarly, if there was the Z ordinate for this member as well, it would have been determined as TAB ZB minus ZA, right? This is considering the joint A. Meaning, if we are supposed to take the components of the forces at joint A, this would be TAB. If we were supposed to calculate what would be the component of forces at joint B, this would have been TBA XA minus XB, right? So the generalized format would be T nearer farther in the bracket X farther minus X nearer, right? Using this simple ordinate or coordinates, we can avoid analyzing the value of theta, and simply we can obtain the value of a value or component of the forces that are acting in the various members of the truss, right? So straight away we'll be taking example. As you can see here, we are having a 3D truss frame, right? It is having members AF, BE, BF, FE, EC and FD. The frame is pinned to a vertical vertical wall at A, B, C and D. ABCD forms a square as shown. Also, ABEF is a rectangle in a horizontal plane. ABEF is a rectangle in a horizontal plane. Using the method of tension coefficient, we are supposed to find out the forces in the members due to load of 100 kN that is acting at joint E in the direction of D. So first of all, we are supposed to determine what are the relative distances of the members, these inclined members, as we don't know the value or length of these members, right? So we initially assume A as the origin, and as you can see here, the side view can be observed like this. This AFD is actually like this, and by using Pythagoras theorem we can obtain the value of FD, which is coming out to be 5 meters. Also, in order to determine what would be the component of the external forces, we are supposed here, one important thing that must be noted is that we are taking only the component of the external forces, and in order to analyze the internal forces, we won't be taking any cos theta or sin theta components. Just to analyze or determine what component or what are the values of the external forces that are acting in the x, y and z direction, we are taking the components, right? So this theta is first of all determined, and the component in the EC and FE members are determined for the external loading only. And once we have calculated what are the forces acting in the EF and EC members, we can determine what would be the external force acting in the BE and EF direction, right? So thereby we'll be getting the component of the external forces in the X, Y and Z direction, right? So just by breaking down the external forces into various components, we have obtained the value of Fx, Fy and Fz due to the external loading. Now with respect to A, we have obtained the value of X, Y and Z coordinates of various points on the truss, right? On this space truss, we have obtained what are the values of various points, right, in terms of X, Y and Z, and thereby we are just applying the equation of equilibrium or equilibrium of forces on the various joints. Firstly, we'll be considering joint E. At joint E, we are having members BE, EC and EF, right? These are relatively in the different directions, and in order to apply the equilibrium of forces, we'll be just having the components in the various directions, right? Now here TEF XF minus XE is basically the component of force in the member EF in the direction X. Similarly, this TEC XC minus XE is the component of the force in the member EC in the direction of X axis, right? And this is the external force, the component of the external force that is acting in the X direction. Similarly, by applying this equation TEF YF minus YE, we are indeed taking the component of the force that is acting in the EF member in the direction of Y axis. And similarly here, we are taking the component in the Z direction, and thereby we have obtained the equilibrium equation of all the forces in the X, Y and Z direction. Solving these equations, we obtain TEF, TEC and TEB. And multiplying, as we have already discussed, tension coefficient is basically the tensile force acting in the member divided by its length. So the force actually acting in the member EF would be tension coefficient multiplied by the length of that member. Here the negative sign signifies that the force is acting indeed is the compression force, right? So initially we have already assumed, we always assume that the forces are tensile in nature, and if finally we obtain negative value, we say that the values are indeed compressive in nature. Similarly, at joint F, we apply or we resolve the forces in x, y and z direction, and thereby we obtain the value of forces in the various members, and thereby our whole truss is analyzed. So this was regarding the various approximate methods that are used in order to determine the lateral forces effect on the bedding frame, and a brief introduction about the tension coefficient method of analysis.